The clock strikes 12 in Manhattan, one of the most densely populated areas in New York City and the entire United States. Millions of people live, work, and travel in this bustling borough every day, filled to the brim with commuters from Queens, Brooklyn, and the Bronx. Each year, tens of millions of tourists also visit Manhattan to see the colorful billboards of Times Square and the elegant greenery of Central Park. Nicknamed the center of the universe, Manhattan is home to thousands of landmarks of American culture, architecture, and entertainment. But one weapon of mass destruction could rapidly reduce this modern metropolis to ash and rubble. 1 minute past noon, an unmarked bomber flies over Manhattan carrying multiple thermonuclear weapons, also known as hydrogen bombs. These weapons of mass destruction can generate explosions thousands of times more powerful than the atomic bombs dropped on Hiroshima and Nagasaki in 1945. The largest thermonuclear weapon ever constructed was the Soviet RDS-220, nicknamed Tsar Bomba, or the King of Bombs. During the Cold War, Tsar Bomba was designed by the Soviet Union as a demonstration of its military power. Tsar Bomba's one and only test produced an approximate yield of 50 megatons, or 50 million tons of TNT, making it the most powerful man-made explosive in history. Not all thermonuclear weapons yield as much power as Tsar Bomba, but even lesser bombs, like the United States B-41, can bring unimaginable destruction. The tremendous energy generated by any thermonuclear weapon comes from a combination of two chemical processes, nuclear fission and nuclear fusion. Atomic bombs, like those dropped on Japan, rely exclusively on nuclear fission, splitting large atoms into smaller nuclei to create energy. Thermonuclear weapons still use fission to generate heat and explosive power, but they also employ nuclear fusion, combining smaller hydrogen atoms under extremely high temperatures. Hydrogen isotopes like tritium or deuterium typically repulse one another when they are ionized and given a positive charge. But with enough kinetic energy, they can overcome their repulsion and fuse into a larger atom of helium. In doing so, they shed a small percentage of their mass, which is converted into energy. According to Einstein's famous equation, energy equals mass multiplied by the speed of light squared. Thus, these tiny chemical reactions produce enough energy for a catastrophic blast. At the moment of detonation, a primary fission reaction causes temperatures inside the bomb to skyrocket to over 100 million degrees. Heat rushes through the detonation system and sparks a fusion reaction in the bomb's gaseous fuel, which contains isotopes of hydrogen. The fusion fuel, in turn, triggers fission within a so-called spark plug made from uranium or plutonium. This chemical chain reaction allows some hydrogen bombs to generate as much explosive power as several million tons of TNT. This particular weapon, dropped from a mysterious bomber onto New York City, detonates about a mile above the ground to maximize its damage and destruction. A fraction of a second later, onlookers of the explosion are blinded by a white flash of light, briefly shining brighter than the sun. A massive fireball erupts outward and vaporizes almost everything it touches. New York City's high-rises and taxicabs turn to dust as the temperature of the fireball climbs to tens of millions of degrees. The fireball releases a ring of thermal energy from its core that scorches all living things and causes extreme damage to all but the most hardened structures. Famous skyscrapers like the Empire State Building collapse in blazing piles of rubble. The vegetation in Central Park is reduced to ash, and all combustible materials melt or burst into flames. Nearly 100% of people inside this thermal ring suffer fatal third-degree burns, destroying their nerves, hair, and multiple layers of skin. As the fireball rapidly expands, it pushes back the surrounding air, and a shockwave or air blast radiates from the center of the explosion at supersonic speeds. This shockwave generates winds over 600 kilometers per hour that tear the roofs off buildings and launch cars, road signs, and chunks of metal like cannonballs through the streets of New York City. Gas tanks and power lines explode as buildings and bridges, weakened by extreme heat and pressure, crumble like towers of sand. Within seconds of the blast, most of Midtown Manhattan and its hundreds of cultural landmarks are smashed, melted, and reduced to rubble. Around Ground Zero, a fierce updraft sweeps hot, vaporized debris into the atmosphere, forming a mushroom-shaped cloud taller than any structure on Earth. Vaporized debris bonds with radioactive particles inside the cloud, creating radioactive dust or fallout. After about 10 minutes, the red-hot vapor cools and condenses, and the mushroom cloud reaches its maximum height. Soon, fallout rains down onto the Earth, contaminating almost everything it touches, including water supplies like the Hudson River. Countless homes and streets are coated in fallout, exposing hundreds of thousands of New Yorkers to sickening or possibly lethal doses of radiation. But the people of New York City aren't the only ones at risk. Moderate to high winds can spread radioactive fallout across hundreds of square kilometers. If the wind is blowing northeast from the blast site, areas as far as New Hampshire could be exposed to dangerous radioactive particles. Already, this catastrophic event has ended hundreds of thousands of lives. Those caught in the initial explosion leave no remains except shadows cast on nearby surfaces. But over the next few hours, the fatality rate will climb even higher. Inside the blast zone, survivors of the initial explosion succumb to horrific injuries like third-degree burns and shattered bones. Others are crushed or suffocated under piles of rubble and radioactive debris. Many more people are injured or killed in the raging wildfires spreading rapidly through New York City's densely populated boroughs. By nightfall, hospitals and emergency rooms are overwhelmed by thousands of patients with severe burns, temporary blindness, and other traumatic injuries. Emergency responders rush into the city to save as many people as possible, but the streets of Manhattan are clogged with dangerous debris and still hot enough to melt through skin and rubber. Rescue teams do everything they can to help survivors on the outskirts of the blast zone, though it may be days before they reach anyone near Ground Zero. Without medical treatment, more people succumb to their injuries, and the death toll continues to rise. Meanwhile, radioactive fallout spreads across the northeastern United States, causing another wave of hospitalizations. Thousands are already suffering from acute radiation syndrome, or ARS, which can cause seizures, hair loss, and even cancer, depending on the type and length of exposure. Some people directly exposed to radioactive fallout may not develop symptoms until days or months after the initial explosion. Even at greater distances from Ground Zero, many people are indirectly exposed to radiation through contaminated food or water. Livestock may unknowingly consume radioactive plants or drink from toxic water supplies. Products made from these contaminated animals, like milk or cheese, may be distributed across the United States or worldwide, exposing countless people to dangerous internal radiation. Within months of the initial explosion, some areas of New York City far from the blast zone, like Staten Island or Eastern Queens, may gradually recover. As radiation dissipates and debris is cleared, residents of these areas may return to their homes, but it could be years before most of the city is clean or safe enough for human habitation. Public health and safety aren't the only things in jeopardy after this catastrophic event. The New York metropolitan area is one of the world's largest financial centers, boasting a GDP of nearly $1.6 trillion. If a thermonuclear bomb detonated over New York City, the explosion may trigger a worldwide socio-economic crisis. Having lost valuable employees and specialized personnel, many prominent businesses would declare bankruptcy. The cost of recovery, including decontamination and reconstruction, would also place a substantial burden on the federal government. Though Wall Street may effectively survive, thanks to data backed up in other locations, the destruction of New York City would significantly influence the market and propel the US economy into severe distress. The United States does have defense programs like the Ground-Based Mid-Course Defense, or GMD, to protect American cities from certain nuclear attacks. However, the United States relies heavily on a policy of deterrence to preserve peace among nations armed with nuclear weapons. There are about 12,500 nuclear warheads in the world today, and about 5,200 of them belong to the United States. The US government has long pledged to deploy nuclear weapons only under extreme circumstances. Should a nuclear weapon explode in the epicenter of New York City, killing millions of Americans and devastating national landmarks, the United States may be motivated to unleash the power of its nuclear arsenal. Federal agents could use samples of debris and other clues to trace the original weapon's origins. Only 9 countries in the world have active nuclear weapons, so the US may quickly uncover the source of the weapon and declare war on whichever country it came from. A large-scale nuclear war may endanger hundreds of millions or even billions of people, and potentially release enough debris into the atmosphere to block out the sun. Though it's unlikely to happen, if a nuclear weapon hits New York City tomorrow, the impact would be globally catastrophic for decades to come.